So we have the second paper, which is titled Teaching Visual Language of Design and Implementing It to Teach Other Subjects in Primary School. It is going to be presented by Aditi Parikh from World University of Design, Sonepat, Haryana. Welcome, Aditi. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Professor Rupa. Thank you for this introduction and thank you for this opportunity as well. I will quickly share my screen first. So, greetings of the day to everyone. I am Aditi Parikh, an associate professor at World University of Design. I am an architect and industrial designer based out of Delhi. I have studied from SPA Delhi. For today's presentation, my topic is teaching visual language of design and implementing it to teach other subjects in primary school. So this particular topic came to me while having an informal discussion with some of the students of Design Foundation year of our university. Most of them, they enjoy the new way of learning, which is iterative, visual, and very non-linear. But for few of them, it becomes a bit difficult to get out of the linear way of education system, which is provided by school. So to understand their perspective, we were having this particular discussion, and there were two major topics that we discussed: why they chose design as a career option, and second, what did they think design education will be like. So there were two prominent answers that we got. First, because they didn't like the mainstream subjects, they were boring. And second, because they like creating new things, they like drawing, painting, sketching, etc. And that's what they thought design education also will be like. It will be like making new things, creating huge. And in a way, the answers are pretty relevant, right? Because design is all about creating new things. The conversation, what they missed out in the conversation was the understanding that drawing, painting, sketching is not just, itself is not design, but they are medium of communication so that you can communicate your ideas to others. Also, the second thing which they missed out on was they liked making things, but they like making things for themselves and not for others, while design is most of the time all about making things for others. And that's where I understood the gap was, and that's where they kind of were not able to get out of the linear way of learning, because other mainstream career options, they have prerequisite subject and method also in the school education system. But what is prerequisite for design or for any creative field for that matter? We can say it's art education, but is art education really taken seriously? And are we providing the thinking which is required for design education, for creative education, along with the skills which is there in art education? Art education is still considered as a hobby to get break from their long and stressful hours of study. So to further on understand how to bridge this particular gap, it's a very extensive kind of exercise, but just to understand how to bridge this particular gap, I studied NCF and some of the textbooks which are recommended by NCRT. They are pretty interesting, at least much more interesting than what I had when I was studying in school. There are a lot of suggestive activities in terms of symbols along with the topics, which tells you that you can learn this particular topic, not only in the way of writing and in the verbal manner, but also you can discuss, make, find out, think, etc. And these activities and these symbols are actually suggesting that design is being thought upon as methodology to teach various subjects. But now the question is, if we want design methodologies to be part of mainstream subject, shouldn't design fundamentals be taught first so that they can carry out these activities in much more efficient manner? So the objective of this paper was to find out if design as a formal subject can be introduced, not only as skill-based subject, but also as language, method, and approach, so that they can carry out the task and activities suggested by the textbooks. Also, my selfish motive that it can take some load off from the foundation years of creative education. It can also generate the overall attitude and aptitude, not only for design education, but for life, which are related to self-awareness, empathy, critical thinking, and a lot of other objectives. Now, the objective was not to find out the way in which we can introduce a completely new course, new subject, but if we can merge it with some existing subject. So in quest of finding out this, I started understanding how much number of hours are given to each and every course. And the nearest prerequisite right now is art education, which has been given approximately 20 to 25 percentage of total number of hours. The nearest topic from the art education, which are visual art and craft, which are related to design education, are tentatively getting 8 to 10% pre-primary to upper primary stages, which comes to roughly around 2 to 3 hours per week. Further on, I studied some of the textbooks, and these are my interpretation. The tables are my interpretation of relationship between the subjects and the pedagogical approach which are suggested to teach and learn those subjects. So at the pre-primary level, there are no separate subjects or textbooks. Rather than that, there are goals which are oriented towards overall development of children. The pedagogy is completely based on the method of learning by doing, with various activities oriented towards these goals. At lower primary level, there are formal subjects which are introduced, and they have proper structured textbooks for them, except art education. The pedagogical approach still remains the same, which is based on learning by doing through various activities, interactions, educational games, etc. So at this particular level of lower primary, an introduction to visual language of design in terms of design fundamentals and methods could actually help the pedagogical approach of learning by doing at this stage, not only in terms of technique, but also in terms of thinking, so that they can get some help in terms of carry out suggested activities in much more efficient and explorative manner. At upper primary level, the mainstream subjects are becoming more intense, focusing more on verbal and written knowledge gain. The textbook at this level are suggesting activities and projects which can be carried out by students to understand and explore subjects practically. All the learnings that they can have from the design fundamentals at the previous level, they can actually be applied here to help them execute these projects methodologically, along with providing a lot of fun and exploration. Coming to the proposal is based on the idea that design is not only about skills, which we are providing them through art education, but it also is about thinking. Now, how to combine these skills to not only represent your thinking, but also to generate thinking? This aspect could be brought in by design. In terms of the structure and the framework of the design education, the proposal is based on the idea that art education can be divided into two parts, containing all the topics which are already there. In terms of design and performing arts, design can right away start from pre-primary stage with introduction to basic design elements like lines, dots, shapes, etc. At primary level, these elements can merge with principles, making them understand the language of design, the visual language, along with the written and verbal language. At upper primary level, the application of design fundamentals can happen, which can help them in learning of other mainstream subjects as well. At the secondary level, they can have choice between going for technological-oriented design or visual art. Higher secondary level, they might be having some rough idea about in which career option they want to go for. So that can become an elective subject. The suggestion is to teach design in a bit more structured manner at primary stage, where other subjects are suggested to be taught in learning by doing method, so that they could apply their methods and teachings of design education in learning of other subjects. The structure could remain only with teachers, so they have some guidelines based on which they can design activities for design education subject. It's all about connecting various subjects together. The pedagogy and methods of design education could actually take load off from the memory-based learning of other subjects, encouraging them to take upon explorative-based learning. So here the idea is to understand design fundamentals and visual language as any other mode of communication. We have techniques to teach alphabets, Similarly, we have techniques to teach design elements. At the later stage, they have to be taught how to combine these alphabets together to form words and how to combine words together to form sentences. In a similar way, at the later stage, the elements, the line shapes, colors, textures, they can be taught how to combine these elements together with the help of principles like harmony, rhythm, subtraction, combination, etc., which are like grammatical principles for visual language. And this could become the design fundamentals, and the visual language can actually become tool for thinking, learning, and representation at various stages of school. Children are born visual thinkers. We are making them written and verbal thinkers by not introducing this particular visual language. Now, visual language cannot be taught in a linear manner, as it's not entirely based on principles and grammar. It also contains aspects of perception and expression. And that iterates person to person. So it has to be taught in a very iterative and non-linear manner. So here I am proposing five peripheral approaches based on which various activities could be designed, contributing directly into the learning of design fundamentals. These approaches are providing learnings which are essential for child development, and they are also essential for learning design fundamentals. For an example, visual art, it teaches self-expression, visual skills, the characteristics and properties of different elements and principles can also be taught in visual arts. Environmental awareness is essential to make them understand their surroundings so that their observational, analytical, critical thinking skills can be enhanced. Along with, they start empathizing with their surroundings and surrounding people. Material exploration is all about building up their confidence for creating new things, enhancing their tactile perception so that they can understand different properties and characteristics of material. Sensorial development to make them understand that it's not only about the eyes, there are other senses which has to contribute to create any certain experience. It also enhances the abstract perception of abstract thoughts, signs and symbols, etc. Tools and techniques is all about making them understand it's not only the sketching and painting which can express your ideas and communicate your ideas. There are other tools which can help you, not only physical tools, but also the digital tools. These learnings and these peripheral approaches can actually help them in learning other subjects at all the stages. The textbooks are already giving them suggestions based on this. It's only about we make them understand and we make them enable to carry out these activities in much more efficient manner. And in turn, when they are actually doing those activities, it also enhances their understanding of design fundamentals further on. Further on, the paper also goes into the detail of providing some of the guideline or the examples for the activities based on the approaches which are leading towards understanding of design principles. It's a very lengthy kind of a paper, so I'm not going to get into details of everything, but just to give you some idea about what kind of exercises can be done. The visual art-based exercises where overlapping, subtraction, combination, objects, not only in terms of the object itself, but breaking down into the geometry, understanding their surroundings through textures and representing their emotions into colors and strokes. Similarly, the exercises related to tools and techniques and material explorations. This one exercise we did with some of the students, and it was based on the idea of painting along with music, and they created very beautiful paintings in rhythm with different musics which were being played. And they actually understood how the colors can be combined with the essence of the music and how the strokes are coming out as per the beats, how the colors are floating on the pages as per the music that has been played. There are some limitations for this paper. So system-based limitations like limited number of hours which can be given to design infrastructure, teachers who can teach the subject, coordination between the teachers, The proposed framework and model are completely based on my experiences and exploration in design education at UG level and my experience with kids as toy designer. Few practical experimentations have been carried out in modules, but not in one stretch as per the framework itself. That has to be done still. The paper is based on the fact that some of the exercises of foundation year of UG level design education are so simple and basic that they can be introduced during school level. Proposed framework should not be seen as guidelines to develop curriculum and not to be seen as syllabus or curriculum itself. The connection between designers and school teachers becomes very vital for this proposal to be implemented. And finally, to conclude, the framework is designed keeping in mind the need of an hour, which is designed as a mainstream subject in school curriculum. Rather than completely thinking about a new course, we still have the skill-based course, which is art education. Design education can actually be combined with it. The concept of this framework is not only to introduce design as subject, but also to introduce design as language, tool, and method. The suggestive activities given in subject textbooks of primary and upper primary school should get their results, not only in terms of homework, but in terms of a systematically carried out assignments and project. And the basic objective is to convert the school education system, which is based on the memory and compulsion, into a system which is based on choice. And these are some of the references without which I would not have been able to complete the study and papers. Thank you so much for being with me. I will open the stage for question and answer. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Aditi. So coming back to this paper, thank you so much. And I totally understand and empathize with what you're saying. You know, we face that all the time when we have students coming in into the foundation year. And no matter how much exposure they've had about design in their various counseling sessions, it is just not enough. And they come with some misconceptions about design. So what you're suggesting is very interesting. But it is only for, you looked at the National Curriculum Framework, you say.
Yes.
And then for the NCERT books and for the CBSE syllabus term.
Yes.
Is what you're looking at, which is in itself has a very large footprint. But there are so many other kinds of schooling systems that we have now. So probably one could look at that. While we wait for questions in the chat box, I was just wondering, if one has looked at the new education policy, you know, because there are a lot of things which yes. are very encouraging, but of course it is still on paper. How it's going to be implemented is really depends on us. But since I didn't see any mention in your paper, could you talk about
it? The paper actually was written in 2019, which was before the new education okay. policy.
So probably one can reflect on it now.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's okay. So would you like to say something about that? Is there something that is already there and, you know, this can plug into that?
Definitely, 100%. I think the new education policy, which is suggesting a lot of exploration-based learning rather than memory and compulsion-based learning, I think definitely it can plug the whole research and the whole framework can actually plug in with the new policy. The idea, whole idea was to, you know, not only based on the fact that the students who are coming for design education, they are not understanding design in terms of its concepts and its outcome and the process itself. It's also based on the idea that there are a lot of things which we teach in design foundation, which I actually feel that they are so basic. They are like ABCD, right? We are teaching them alphabets, and in similar way, and the design foundation level, we are teaching them how to make lines, how to make parallel lines, how to understand different types of strokes, how to understand different types of colors. So this teaching, if we are able to teach them 2 + 2 = 4, in my opinion, it's not very difficult. If we actually give a thought over it, it's not very difficult to make them understand how to read the visual language.
Right. Yeah, I get it. Yeah, so I mean, I think, you know, if we do this, of course, it's going to cut down on the basics. And it is also going to, probably we don't have to say anymore that you need to unlearn what you have learned in school
exactly.
and then relearn again. So the yes. unlearning process that does not need to happen. And also probably all the coaching centers with your framework will probably lose business. That's something to think about. I was just thinking, I looked at your references and most of them were from NCRT and Indian, which is very, which is appreciated. But, you know, there's so much work which is happening world over in this context. I think it will be really interesting to look at their frameworks and probably use some of them over here.
Yes, definitely.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.